What would you say if I told you that 80 to 90% of you is not you? 80 to 90% of the cells in your body are not part of you. Welcome to Shape Fixer. I'm Andrew. I am a nutritionist and a biology and science teacher. And you have somewhere in the region of 200 trillion bacteria, fungi, viruses living inside your body. Most of them are in your gut. Definitely not all of them, but most of them are. And those are the ones we're going to talk about in this video. Because without those microbes living in your gut, you would not survive. So what are they doing? They are playing a very, very vital role in a number of areas of your life. Firstly, digestion. They have a huge job aiding your digestive process in breaking down food compounds that you can't do yourself because you don't have the enzymes to do it. So they will break the food down into smaller compounds that you can then absorb and use. So without them, you'd have serious gastrointestinal and digestive problems. They also play a very vital role in your immune system. Not only do they produce antioxidants to help repair and heal us, but they also fight pathogens, which are microbes that might get into your gut through food that's been infected or past its sell-by date, or that you take in from your hands, and will fight them and kill them for you. So it's your little army that you've got down there keeping you healthy and safe. And then the third thing they do, which is hugely underappreciated, is that they, in their metabolic processes, produce chemicals that we then use to produce hormones. So things like serotonin, which is your happiness hormone, or dopamine, which is your motivation hormone. They play a role in the production of melatonin, which is part of your cocktail of hormones that helps you sleep, and they even play a role in the production of adrenaline. So again, without them, you would have serious mental health issues. The bottom line is you couldn't survive without them. So if you have a lot of diarrhea, or on the other hand, constipation, or you're just very malnourished and you've lost a lot of weight and you can't seem to put your weight back on, or you're suffering from anxiety, suffering from depression, you get sick a lot, it could be that your microbiome, which is what we call the world that the microbes live in, it actually means miniature world, microbiome, is not healthy. Now, go to your doctor if you have any of those symptoms, obviously, because there are lots of other things that will cause mental health issues or diarrhea or anything like that. But it could be that your microbiome is not healthy. And if your microbiome is not healthy, there is no medication that is going to fix that. You can take a medication to loosen you up if you have constipation. You can take medications that interfere with your hormones to try and address an imbalance that is causing anxiety or depression, but you need to heal your microbiome if that's the cause of the issue. Now, what are the things that we do that damage our microbiome? Because if we know what those are and we avoid them, we will go a long way to maintaining a healthy microbiome, having good digestion, having good hormones, and not being sick all the time. So the first one I'm going to come to is sugar. Sugar, for all the issues that we already know and understand about sugar, okay, sugar makes you fat, sugar gives you diabetes, sugar contributes to heart disease. Even Alzheimer's dementia is now known as type 3 diabetes, sugar. Sugar also feeds pathogens. So any infections that you have, any bad microbes that your healthy microbes would normally destroy, are nourished by the sugar in your diet, and your healthy microbes are not. So you're tilting the balance against yourself. You are supplying ammunition to the enemy microbes every time you eat sugar or carbohydrates. So there's another reason to be on a low carbohydrate diet. Just avoid sugar. And that leads me on to grains, which are essentially just grass seeds. They're not real human food. In the link down below here, there's a video on grains and the history of our using grains as a staple in our diet. It doesn't go back very far. Grains obviously are full of starch, which is sugar, so we've already discussed the sugar issue, but grains also have chemicals in them with antibacterial properties. So you are damaging your microbes with the chemicals that come with the grains. So cut grains down or out of your diet. And seed oil or vegetable oil, most vegetable oils come from the seeds of the vegetables like soya, sunflower, safflower, canola. These are all chemically manufactured oils that are toxic, they are inflammatory, and anything that you consume that is inflammatory is going to damage your microbiome. So avoid seed oils and vegetable oils. All processed food, ultra-processed food, try to keep your processed food to a minimum because of the chemicals that are in the processed food. The colorants, the emulsifiers, the stabilizers, the preservatives, all these chemicals can do damage to your microbiome. Alcohol is an absolute killer. If you remember the COVID pandemic, people were using alcohol to wipe their hands and to wipe surfaces to kill the microbes. What happens when you think, what do you think happens to it when you drink it? It kills everything. So again, there are other reasons to cut down alcohol if you can't cut it out altogether. But for the sake of your having a healthy gut, it's a very bad idea to be drinking alcohol. A lot of medications will damage your gut. The obvious one is antibiotics. That's the point of an antibiotic, is to kill microbes, but it will kill all the microbes, which is why very often when you do have an antibiotic, your doctor will prescribe a probiotic, which is a top-up of microbes at the same time that you're killing the microbes. So really, you should be taking your probiotic for a while after the antibiotics as well to try and reboot your microbiome. And acid or antacid medications like omeprazole to lower your stomach acidity cause chaos too, because when you lower your stomach acidity, your digestive system doesn't work so well. Proteins will go through your stomach into your gut where they should not be, because they should be dissolved in the acid in your stomach, and they can cause havoc with your microbiome as well. Sweeteners, artificial sweeteners, nearly all of them are bad for your gut microbes. I'm linking another video in the description down below here on sweeteners, sugar alternatives that I've done. But the bottom line is, if you're weaning yourself off sugar by using a sweetener, you want to extrapolate from that process and wean yourself ultimately off the sweeteners altogether. So you overcome the sweet tooth so that you're not damaging your microbes with sweeteners, and you no longer have the urge for sugar. So the sooner you can get rid of your sweet tooth, the better. Water that has been treated with fluoride or chlorinated water, chlorine and fluorine in the water, is put there to kill microbes in the water. And the idea behind that obviously being to make sure that you'll have a less chance of picking up an infection from drinking that water. But the problem is then you drink that water and the fluoride and the chlorine, and then that kills your microbes. So try to use distilled water or have a reverse osmosis filter in your house to take those chemicals out again before you drink them. And then one of the real difficult ones to overcome is stress. And we have a lot of stress in our modern world. And stress manifests a rise in cortisol, which is your stress hormone. And your stress hormone is toxic to your microbiome, which is exactly why one of the reasons why when you have a lot of stress, you end up picking up infections or getting ill, because your immune system is down. Why? Because your gut microbes are suffering. So what do we do to keep them healthy? A lot of those points that I made are kind of self-explanatory. Well, if sugars are going to kill my microbes, I shouldn't be eating sugar, so I'm going to cut sugar out. There you go. But what do you eat? You eat good, whole, healthy foods, foods that you can identify. They're not full of sugar. They're low carb. They're not processed, so they don't have chemicals in them. And you know what it is that you're actually eating to make sure you get all the nutrients that your body needs without the toxic chemicals that are going to damage your microbes. You need to fast. Now, that's not as drastic as it sounds. You fast all the time between meals, because all fasting means is not eating. And there are times of the day that we're not eating. Our longest fast generally is when we're asleep in bed, because you can go 8 hours, 7, 8, 9 hours without eating. That's a fast. And your microbes want downtime. They need time that they're not digesting food so that they can do other things and rebuild your hormones and repair themselves and do a little bit of housekeeping. Ideally, you probably want a 14-hour fast, intermittent fast every day for the sake of your microbes. Now, that's not so difficult, because if you eat at 8 o'clock at night and then you don't have breakfast until 10 o'clock the next day, that's already 14 hours. It's not that hard. There are other reasons to use intermittent fasting as a strategy for health, and you probably want to go 16 hours. There's a video down below here about that, and there are other benefits of intermittent fasting. But for the sake of your microbes, you want to try for 12 to 14 hours downtime and fasting. And we're talking about fasting and being asleep. So sleep, not only are you fasting when you're asleep, but when you're asleep, your stress hormones come down. So your microbes get the benefit of that as well. Your cortisol level will settle and they will have a chance to operate and to regenerate themselves. So sleep is very good for lowering your stress. And the other great way to lower your stress and to keep your cortisol under control is exercise. So exercise for your gut microbes, believe it or not. And that doesn't mean running a marathon or going to boot camp. You could just walk the dogs or go and work in your garden. It's exercise, it's movement, it's getting your heart rate up a little bit, it's nice healthy breathing, getting outdoors, getting some sunlight, because sunlight helps you produce vitamin D, which is also very important for your hormones. For example, they can't make serotonin, which keeps you happy, if you don't have vitamin D. So the microbes need you to be outdoors in the sun. Then you can take probiotics, and we did mention probiotics earlier, particularly if you've been on antibiotics, then you need a probiotic to replace the microbes that you killed. But if you are eating probiotics every day, going out of your way to have cultured yogurt, fermented foods, foods that are high in probiotics, or taking a supplement, because you've been told you need to do that every day, if you really do need to do that every day, then what are you doing to your microbes to kill them off every day that you need to keep replacing them? Your gut should be a nice, warm, cozy, safe place for them to flourish and multiply. You shouldn't need to keep topping them up. So if you are topping them up, A, do you really need to be doing that? And if so, why? Then you go back to this video and you look at all the things that you might be doing that are destroying your microbes. And then it will make sense. But otherwise, you really don't need to be doing that. You take a probiotic when you've been on antibiotics. You take a probiotic if you've had an upset stomach and diarrhea, because a lot of your microbes will have gone. Otherwise, generally speaking, it's not really necessary. And there's one other thing, and I can hear you from here asking, why did he not mention fiber? Surely we all need to be eating fiber, because we all know that fiber is essential to feed our microbes. Well, the news is out. The research is now in. We do not. It's a myth. We learned this in 1957 and it hasn't gone away. And yet there are no scientific studies whatsoever that prove that fiber is essential to the functioning of our microbiome. Now, we have some microbes that can eat fiber, but we don't have to. And thousands, probably hundreds of thousands of people now do not eat fiber, and their gut is absolutely fine. I don't want to get into fiber too much here because this is not what this video is about. Suffice to say, you don't need it. If you're not sure about that, look at the video about down below about fiber. In fact, I'm going to attach it here somewhere on the screen at the end of this video, and that video will explain to you in more detail why we don't actually need fiber. And in the video notes of that video, there are also other videos and studies and references that you can go and have a look at. So your body will be fine without fiber. You should be fine without probiotics, unless, as I say, you've been sick, or you have had a binge, an alcohol bender at a wedding or something, and probably poisoned a whole lot of them. The rest of the time, you'll be fine. Eat healthy, whole foods, avoid sugar, avoid toxic chemicals, get good sleep, get some exercise, try and manage your stress, and your microbes will keep you healthy and happy for as long as you keep them healthy and happy. Go and watch the video on fiber. Please like this video and subscribe to our channel.